Here. Touch the thing right there. My name is Clancy Immersland, and I'm an alcoholic. This has really been a series of ups and downs this weekend. Last night I was Mother Teresa. This morning I was Captain Bly. Tonight I'm Jesus. Laugh if you want, but I've cured a lot of lepers in Seattle. I'm very pleased to be here this evening, safe and sane and sober, as I like to say. I've really enjoyed this meeting. Bob has done a good job. He's done a remarkable job on this thing. I watched it from the beginning, and he told me his secret of how he got the right people. He said he would listen for people who did an especially good job on a particular step, and you'd have them come and talk about that step. And I think that really worked out. I guess Charlie was pretty good on all the steps, huh? But Carl, Friday night, I've heard him talk many times. He and I have some things in common. We're both depraved Norwegian Lutherans, and neither one of us were much of an asset to the Navy. But I'll tell you one thing about him, and I hope you noticed this as I did. It's some kind of magic up here. He had a bottle this big. He took 22 swigs off it, and there's some in there. It's just a bottomless goddamn bottle of water. Can you imagine? And I enjoyed it. And Marilyn last night gave such a touching and beautiful talk. And I want to tell you something. I'm sure it's no longer a secret. But she called me in the middle of the night last night, feeling very bad. They just called her and said her son had been found dead last night. And so she was going to drive back to, told her I'd be glad to go with her if she wanted to, but she wanted to be alone, she said, and think about it. That's a terrible thing. And then she got back to Los Angeles and found out while she was speaking last night, he hanged himself. What a terrible, terrible thing, without a note, so she can go with the rest of her life thinking, what did I do wrong? Where should I have stepped in? What should I have done? You know, it's just a terrible, terrible thing. And she's such a wonderful girl. She's done such a good job. I enjoyed our morning speaker who spoke on steps 4 and 5. I haven't heard him speak since last Friday. It's kind of a reunion. We were down somewhere around Atlanta trying to make our way through a large group of shit kickers. Frank gave a wonderful talk, vicious and malicious and cruel, and you should have seen him before he got well. And then Mike talked on the 8th and 9th steps. Now, I'll tell you something funny. Did you notice this? Mike really was kind of a rotten guy. He talked about everything his father asked him to do, screw you, his mother, And Frank was a rotten kid. They both are Vietnamese veterans. Now, let me tell you a little bit how much different we from World War II are. Love is the answer. Charlie, I've known for a long time, gave a fine talk. And tomorrow morning, there are going to be two more good talks, excellent talks. But I'm not trusted with a step. I offered to do step 13, but I'm out of date for that. I'm now on step 14. I don't know if you know what step 14 is. You will someday. That's when you're too old to do step 13, but they let you watch. But we're all here for one reason, which reminds me, a couple days ago, I heard a singing and noise in the front of my house about 1 in the morning. And I just looked out the window, and here's some drunk walking up and down, stepping up and down on the curb and having a terrible time. And out, and I said, "Where are you going, pal?" He said, "I'm going to a lecture on alcoholism." I said, "Where are you going to find that this time of night?" "At my house." Well, but Alcoholics Anonymous, we all agree. I mean, one thing about a place like this, people don't come here who don't believe in AA. People who come here are, as we say, we're preaching to the choir. But it's always good to preach to anybody who listens to the preaching. But the Alcoholics Anonymous has been a remarkable thing. I've sometimes thought, I hope we haven't passed the noon of Alcoholics Anonymous, because we have lived in the noon of Alcoholics Anonymous. And I hope it isn't going little by little away from us. And there's today there's, you know, we talk about that there's a lot of division in AA. But there always was, I'll tell you that. I got sober in, I should give my sobriety date, October 31st, 1958. And I'm a member of the Pacific Group in Los Angeles. And I remember when I first got sober, the old timers were saying, "You should have been by here 10 years ago. There wasn't any beef, but we were all getting along." But they weren't getting along then either. Because Alcoholics is a funny place. It just breeds discontent amongst its members. I don't know why they do it. But any city you see with one group in it, you go back next year, there'll be another group made up of half of that group explaining why they're no longer good AAs. And almost all of the groups in the world have started based on, "I'll show you." And they eventually become great AA groups. The largest group in Minnesota, I remember a couple of our members moved there a few years ago and said, "We don't like the meetings here. They're not like our meetings." I said, "We'll start one." So they started one. Now it's the biggest group in Minnesota. And New York, Peggy's and her friends started a group there based on our group in Los Angeles, now the biggest group in New York. And it's nothing really remarkable about it, except that eventually what starts with disunion gradually becomes part of the environment. And today, I travel around a lot, as many of our speakers do, and I run across from time to time the divisions, the fights in AA. And there seem to be three major movements today in various parts of the world. One movement is, let's get rid of this singleness of purpose. So many young people are now addicts that we are keeping them out of AA, we are keeping them from recovery, and it shouldn't be done that way. And, you know, maybe at one time it was necessary, but not anymore, certainly. And that's not a good argument. Another one is that we should diminish our talk about God in AA, because it offends a great many new people. We should discontinue the Lord's Prayer because it offends a lot of people. It's a Christian prayer, they say. We are keeping a lot of people from recovery by our old-fashioned manners. The third one, of course, is that just recently in the New York Times, there's a long article, a long letter written in from a man decrying anonymity in Alcoholics Anonymous. He said, "The days of anonymity necessity are gone, long gone. Maybe we need to be protected in 1935. We don't need to be protected now. It's a proud and honorable place, and we have to." And it started a flurry of letters to the Times, all agreeing with him. And they all sound exactly right until you realize what they're talking about. Why in the world are we saddled with this singleness of purpose crap? We have to be an alcoholic to be an AA. And you really have to go to the germ of it, goes back in history a little bit. Mrs. Bazan's heard the same stuff last week, but simulate interest. But we all know that Bill Wilson turned into the town's hospital finally, and his wife called, his doctor called his wife and said, "Mrs. Smith, or Mrs. Wilson, I'm so sorry, but your husband is here again, and I got some bad news. I don't think he'll be back here again. He'll be dead before he's back next time. He's far too far gone." And she was just terribly concerned about that. And she called Ebby, who had been in touch with him. And he was in a mission over on Park Avenue or Broadway. And he went up to the hospital to see Bill, and he brought a couple of his Oxford group friends with him. They said, Bill, I don't see any other way you're going to do this except to find a power greater than yourself. And Bill said, I don't want to hear that crap. Religion never helped anybody. And, okay, so they went home. And we all know the story. In the middle of the night, he woke up with a terrible fear, and he knew that he was going to die. He was going to die a drunken death, not this time, next time certainly. And he cried out, if there's a God there, show yourself! And then he wrote later, all of a sudden, the room was filled with light. And there was no return on the light. And a wind blew through the closed windows. He said, I'm going crazy. I'm going insane. I'm going, my God, what is this? But he had a strange feeling. Then all of a sudden, the lights dimmed again, and the wind went away. And the next morning, he told the doctor about it. He said, doctor, I guess I snapped last night. I had a psychotic experience. The doctor looked at his eyes and said, I don't know what should happen to you, Bill, but talking to you and listening to you, I don't know what happened to you, but whatever happened to you, hang on to it. Hang on to it. You're changed. Now, here's another interesting thing. Some of the naysayers around the world in AA, there's a new description of Bill Wilson's spiritual experience. They say, well, in those days, the town's hospital treated alcoholics with belladonna. And belladonna was notorious for causing hallucinations. And Bill Wilson had a hallucination, and that's about all he had. And I guess that's supposed to make us feel bad or something. But I don't care what he had. Save my ass, I'll tell you that. And he associated this experience with Ebby coming to talk to him about the Oxford group. So he went to the Oxford group, as we all know, and then he thought he had this mission to help drunkards. I've got a mission from God to help drunkards. And he got to the Oxford group, got involved. He went to the Oxford group every day for 6 months. Always picked up a street drunk to bring along to help him. He'd bring him to the Oxford group. And of course, I don't know if you know what the Oxford group by this time had evolved into mostly upper-class families or upper-class people meeting in one another's house, very fine people, discussing the intricacies of how to gain further spiritual insights. And here he comes with this smelly, stinking street drunk, sitting, please, sir, I think you're vomiting on my shoe. And he'd take him home sometimes, put him in his house. Nobody ever stayed sober. Nobody ever stayed sober. He would tell him about the Oxford group and why they had to find their power greater themselves. And nobody ever stayed sober. It didn't work. He got up one day after about 6 months of sobriety, since his spiritual experience, and he noticed that the guy he brought home the night before had left early, stolen the coffee pot apparently to sell for wine. And he looked at his wife, Lois, who'd been a pert society girl when he married her, now a little old before her time, a little salt and pepper haired, putting on her shirt or sweater with a sleeve patch on the sleeve so she could go to work in a cheap department store and work for almost nothing so she could pay the rent, so he could run off to Manhattan and take no more drunks to the Oxford group in vain. And he had a terrible wave of remorse. He said, Lois, I'm so sorry. I realize I've done you a terrible disservice. I thought I had some celestial, godlike calling to help drunkards, but obviously I don't. I've been working with people for 6 months and not one person stayed sober, and I'm done doing it as of today. And I'll tell you one thing, your life and mine hung by a thread about that big that morning. He said, I'm going to get another job if it's only shoveling dirt, but I'm going to take care of you so you don't have to work in that damn department store. I'm done, Lois. Not one person has stayed sober. And our lives were very close to over at that moment. And she turned and said something to him to change the course of history. I had lunch with her about 40 years ago in Hartford, Connecticut. And I asked her, how did you ever think that great answer? You saved our life. She said, oh, it didn't seem so strange to me. seemed quite obvious. He said, not one person has stayed sober. And she said, you did. Oh, yeah. That's why old-timers don't have much hair in front. You just go through life. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Talking about old-timers, I want to mention the speakers last night and some of them today talked about the roaring 60s. Everybody's getting growing up in the 60s and getting drunk in the 60s and what fun it was, how tough it was. I sat with my friend, Mr. Toussaint, last night, and we leaned to each other and said, they should have tried staying sober in the 60s. Go down the street and see another mob of these idiots. I have had to use every fiber of my being just to not think, I'm going to go right through with my car at top speed, and I'll get as many of these little bastards as I can. But I realized that was not the AA way. But she said, you did. And he said, yeah, that's right. But I'm doing something wrong. I don't know what it is. So he went down to Towns Hospital, saw his doctor who had predicted his death recently, and said, doctor, I don't know what's wrong, but I'm trying to help these people. I'm bringing them to the Oxford group. I'm telling them about the Oxford group. And not one person has stayed sober. It's obvious. No drunk ever got sober on religion. Nah. They may, but the chances are so slim, it's almost impossible. He said, I got an idea. And he then had an idea that changed the course of history. He said, instead of talking about religion to him, why don't you talk to him about how you feel and why you drink and apparently what drinking does for you? He said, I can't talk to him about these things. I don't know, it doesn't do anything to me. But it seems to do something to people like you. And tell them. He said, you know, drunkards traditionally are people who are trapped in an invisible shield. And all the advice they get just bounces off it. Here's what I think you ought to do. Thanks a lot, appreciate it. You know, we've all got enough advice to last us 10,000 years. And he said, you got to get through that wall somehow. And the way you get through that wall is not by going to their better nature. It is by getting them to understand that they are not as different as they feel, that there is a solution. He said, okay, I'll try it, but it doesn't sound like very much to me. But coincidentally then, Bill got an offer of a job, as we all know, in Akron, Ohio. He's going to become president of this company, and they said, don't blow it, Bill, because you'll never work again in this town if you do it. We're giving you a big chance because we think you're doing better. So he went out there, and the deal blew up, of course, and he found himself on a hot May morning standing in the hotel. He had a $10 bill in his pocket. He could either pay his hotel bill or buy a train ticket home. And he stood there and he, from over here you could hear out of a door, the jukebox coming out and the tinkle of glasses. I stood in that lobby a few years ago. It was still a hotel, oh, I guess 1971, a long time ago. But. I've got to catch a train now. No such luck, Bunky. Anyway, and he had a thought that is so alcoholic, it's just, I can't imagine anybody not having that thought. He said, if I just had a couple drinks, I could think of the answer. And the music continued and the tinkle of glasses. And he started to go. Every step he took, your life and mine diminished, I'll tell you. Then he noticed out of the corner of his eye some telephones against the wall. And he remembered that he had promised these Oxford goops in New York that he'd call somebody before he did anything. He'd call an Oxford movement person to talk to him before he did anything rash. So he went over there, and I know some, you've been, I'm sure you've seen it in small towns, over the telephones they have a, I think it was a little thing on the ground, listed these churches and the ministers and their phone numbers. And he called the first phone, put a nickel in, he said he'd do it. So he called the first phone, he says, my name is Bill Wilson, I'm a rum hound from New York, I got to talk to somebody in the Oxford group, can you help me? And the man said, I I really don't know what you're talking about. I'm trying to write a sermon. Please don't bother me. And he called the next one, no answer. Called the next one, no answer. Called the next one, the guy said, I can't help you. And he stopped and think now. He said, what would he say? What would you say? What would I say? Well, I did what I said I would do. I just have a couple. But he noticed the last name, there was a funny name, Walter Tunk. So he called Walter Tunk. He said, well, don't miss Walter Tunk. I'm sure he has something to tell me. And by odd coincidence, Walter Tunk was the only man in Akron who could have helped him. He said, funny you should call. I have a parishioner, a rather wealthy woman in West Akron, who told me just a couple days ago that she's in the Oxford group, and one of their Oxford group members, a doctor, admitted he was a drunkard and he couldn't do anything about it. Maybe I can put you in touch with him. He said, okay. And so the minister called the parishioner. The parishioner said, yeah, good idea. That's Mrs. Smith. Let's see if I can get hold of her. And he called Mrs. Smith. And although this is no literature, I heard this 40 years ago from one of the few survivors of that era, and he swore it was true. And he dialed Mrs. Smith, and the phone rang, and rang, and rang, and rang, and she started to hang up. Suddenly, he was answered. Hello, sorry, I was in the yard. And he explained what happened. She said, well, I would like to have the doctor talk to him, but he's drunk on the floor, can't go today. Maybe we can go tomorrow. So she said, yes, made arrangements for the doctor to come out to the parishioner's home. And she called the minister back, and the minister called Bill Wilson back. And Bill was just about ready to leave. He was restless, and he'd heard nothing. But he got told how to get a streetcar and go out to West Akron. And we all know that story. Out they went and they met this woman's gatehouse, very fancy. And Dr. Bob went out there in his car, too hungover to drive. So he had his son, young Smitty, drive, 16 years old, who later became an Al-Anon to show you what punishment he got. And no, I'm just kidding. Some of my best friends are Al-Anons. I wouldn't want my daughter to marry one. But anyway, young Bob was a great guy. He was a good friend of mine, a great friend of many people. When he finally came around, in fact, in 1980, International Convention New Orleans, he stunned the old crowd. He said, we have here tonight Dr. Bob's son. Nobody even knew he had a son. And we jumped up and cheered for 10 minutes. But then he talks about driving out there. His sister sat next to him, his father in the back with his mother. By the way, I want to say one thing. That's his mother's picture over there. Doesn't she look as though she's saying, you drank again, you son of a bitch? Scary. I'm not judging the picture. But anyway, in the back seat, his father all went there and said, Ann, I'll go out there and do it because today's Mother's Day. And I've screwed up your Mother's Day, but I'm so sorry. But I'll give this fool 10 minutes, but no more, maybe 5 minutes. I can't stand any more lectures about my drinking. It makes me crazy. And they got out there and they had a bite to eat, and these two guys disappeared in the room for their 10 minutes and stayed there for several hours and came out, and the doctor said, my God, Ann, I've never met a man who seems to know how I feel and why I drink. I had to believe what he said. He said, my God, that's a miracle. He said, Bill, could you possibly stay with us maybe for a couple weeks just so we could talk some more? And Bill thought, let's see. I have nowhere to get out of town. Yes, I can stay. And so he stayed and they talked for 2 weeks about the niceties of the Oxford group and the spiritual values to be found therein, and the intensity of finding a God that you could relate to. At the end of 2 weeks, the doctor had blossomed into just a wonderful person, feeling great. He said, Bill, I never thought I'd be able to do this, but this week the American Medical Association convention is going on in New Jersey, and I was there last year and I was drunk, and they ridiculed me and I felt like shoot. But I'm going to go this year and I'm going to show them what the Oxford group can do for people. And I'll be back Tuesday morning. And away he went to Atlantic City. Tuesday morning about 7 o'clock, the phone rang at the Smith house. Mrs. Smith said, yes, she said, hello, I'm so sorry. This is the doctor's office nurse. They carried him off the train this morning so drunk he couldn't walk. The station agent knew that I worked for him, so he called me and I came down, and the cab driver and I, we have him here on the floor of his office. I'm so sorry. I know he was trying so hard. And another great experiment failed. So they went down and got him. And not only was he drunk, but he was crying drunk. Nothing in the world more sickening than a crying drunk. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Boom! Now you're sorry. They brought him home and put him to bed. Poor old drunken fool, and he's just so sad. A couple days later, he said, what day is it? He said, it's Thursday. He said, oh my God, oh my God, I've got to do surgery today. Look at my hand, I can't do surgery. He was a proctologist and tried to get a cancer out of someone's colon, and he couldn't get it. Hey, my God, they'll take my license, it'll be so terrible. And so Bill got him a couple bottles of beer and a drug or two to soothe, calm his nerves. And off he went to the hospital. He said, I'll be back about 2 o'clock. Okay, Bob. 2 o'clock came, he didn't come back. 3 o'clock, didn't come back. 4 o'clock, didn't come back. 5 o'clock, son of a bitch is drunk again. 6 o'clock, he burst through the door. Said, I'm home, and he's cold sober. He said, where you been, Bob? He said, when I was doing that operation, it struck me, you know, the Oxford group must say you should make amends, but I never thought a doctor should have to make amends. But I realized I'm a human being before I'm a doctor, so I've been all afternoon all over Akron making amends, and I feel wonderful. And that was June 10th, 1935, which we call the birthday of AA, because neither one of them drank again. But the interesting thing that came out of that operation was this. They realized Bill had never got anybody staying stay sober by keeping talking to him about religion. And they knew they had to talk to somebody, maybe help them how they felt. So Dr. Bob called his friend, Sister Ignatia, the hospital nurse. And at that time, alcoholics, couldn't go in the hospital for alcoholism or drunken. You had to have some physical problem, gastritis, or go in for a gastroendoscopy or whatever it might be. And so she said, yes, we have a man here like that, Bill D, and he's a lawyer who moved here from Louisville some time ago. He said he did that to stop drinking, but he's drinking worse than ever. Maybe you could talk to him. I'll talk to his wife. I heard Bill D talk a few years ago, a number of years ago now. He said, I was laying on that bed in Akron, Ohio, and my wife came to me and said, I have two fellows who wanted to talk to you about your drinking. He said, I'm not going to talk to them. No way. I'm sick of talking to people about my drinking. I don't want to hear any more about it. To hell with it. But my wife's a rather strong woman. So I talked to them two fellas. And they never talked about my drinking once. They talked about their drinking and how they felt and why they drank and what drinking did for them. And I never, ever in my whole life, heard anybody describe me quite so clearly. And I was just so impressed. And I stayed with those fellows, and I've been with them ever since. He became number three in this rather tattered chain. But from then on, it was quite obvious. Talking good thoughts and spiritual values would be of great instance, but to get sober, you had to believe there was somebody that you could believe. And how do you do that? By identification. Identification is the number one answer of AA. Sometimes you hear people say, oh, that, you know, there's, I read another book that had some of the same stuff that Big Book had. Big Book must have stolen it. He stole some of that stuff over here, some of that stuff over there. No question about it. Big Book has got no secret information. What it has is a program that gets it through that wall. That's what it's got. The information itself is generally acceptable. Find it anywhere. But not how to get it through that invisible shield. Identification. And from then on, the nature of alcoholism has always been, as was said earlier, one alcoholic talking to another alcoholic to break down that wall. And over a period of years, it spread that way. And then it, as a matter of fact, in the late 1950s and early 1960s in California, we saw a plethora of 12-step programs. There was a guy there named Jim Willis. He was married to Sybil Willis, great old lady. And he founded, or he had to take some of his gambler friends, he was a gambler, to AA meetings. They said, we don't want to hear those juicers talk. We got nothing in common with them. Come on. So he wrote to New York and got the first permission to use the 12 steps outside of AA, and he founded Gamblers Anonymous, which today is still the biggest and strongest of the non-AA movements. And he got very active in GA. And I remember I knew him quite well, and Sybil, and he was always going somewhere, going to Louisville, going to Chicago, going somewhere, help these people get their GA meetings. He really didn't have time to even go to AA anymore. So people were very sad when he got drunk and died. But as they said in GA, he never gambled again, which made him feel better, I guess. Then some guys over the North Hollywood Club were bringing in narcotics addicts, heroin addicts, to try to get them to understand the steps. I don't want to hear them old drunks. They're sickening. I'm not going to go there. So they wrote to New York and got permission to use the steps, and they founded Narcotics Anonymous, using the same steps in the same book. What's the difference? Identification. There was narcotic addict talking to narcotic addict. Then some guys out in the marina were a little more wealthy, wrote in and got permission to use the word cocaine and started Cocaine Anonymous. A woman in the Mid-Wilshire District started Overeaters Anonymous, and they are the four major non-AA 12-step movements. And they all, to one degree or another, flourish. Narcotics Anonymous has had a lot of trouble in many areas in the world because, unfortunately, addicts seem to be more interested in being cool than being well. Hey, man, chill, will you? I don't hear that step shit. Come on. But that's what they do. But I, you know, I see all these meetings, and what the hell are all these steps meetings are for? I never understood it until, this is an example I've used 100 times, might as well use 101. When I was about 2 years sober, I still had no front teeth, and I weighed about 125 pounds of gaunt, skinny, toothless puke. But I was on fire because I was staying sober for the first time after slipping 10 years. And I believed in the program, it was working. These steps really working. I was giving a club talk at the club one day on obsessions. I'm an authority on obsessions. Not only recovery from them, just the obsessions. And some woman came afterward, a rather plump woman. She said, that was really fascinating. I've never heard anybody talk about those things. I've started a little organization called Overeaters Anonymous. Would you come to our meeting? We're meeting with Christ the King Church on Hollywood or Olympic Boulevard. Could you come over Sunday? I said, sure. I'll let them show them what they can shoot for someday. So I went over there and eight fat women sitting around a table. You shouldn't laugh. I mean, that's not funny. And I gave a great talk on obsessions, and they ate it up. Sorry, I didn't mean that. I mean, they really liked it. Yeah. And I sat down, pleased with a job well done of missionary work, and then they had a little sharing session. And I couldn't believe my ears what I was hearing. This woman over here, her little boy had just had his 10th birthday. He's in the military school in Long Beach. She sent her husband down to pick him up. She got out the cake to surprise him. took a piece just to taste it. Not the little piece, just to... By the time I got back, she'd eaten the whole cake. And she just felt so terrible. Oh, I'm so sorry. And I didn't say anything, because I'm a nice guy. But I want to say, why'd you just have a piece and forget it, for Christ's sake? What's wrong with you? Yeah. Woman over here talked about ice cream. She crazed for ice cream. Couldn't wait for her husband to get up in the morning, go to work, so she could get out of the store, get ice cream, and just loved it. It seemed to fulfill all of her needs. It's just wonderful. I didn't say anything. I'm a nice guy. I wanted to say, no wonder you're fat, for crying out loud. Eat that much ice cream, you're bound to be fat. But my favorite is over here. This woman said she ate till she couldn't eat anymore. Then she put her finger down her throat and puked it up so she could eat some more. And I didn't say anything. But I felt like saying, don't bother shaking hands with me, Miss Slimy Finger. Now, what I understood what she's saying. I've done that for drinking a lot. Late Sunday, Saturday afternoon, sun's still up. Jesus. So I give a few more hours. But not for eating. Now, what was the difference? I'm rather smart. I understand. I should understand their nature. I try to empathize with them. But I didn't identify with them. So just aberrant behavior. Just aberrant behavior. Why would you do that? Why would you eat like that? I eat food and I don't just gobble up. What's wrong with you? And that's why you and I will spend our lives, hopefully, not trying to convince our family that we've got something that, you know, we all have heard, you can't even have a glass of wine at Christmas. I can't even have a glass of wine in July, because then I won't be home Christmas. Yeah. But you don't try to explain, you just have to explain that it makes you feel, it makes your life turn better. But one of the great things about, that's what makes AA work, is identification. Without identification, you get the Tower of Babel. And that's what people don't seem to understand. Why can't young addicts come in and join? Because they have nothing to tell me, and I have nothing to tell them, really. Bill Wilson wrote a little pamphlet called Problems Other Than Alcohol, specifically states, can a non-alcoholic be a member of AA? No. Should we make them feel they're a member of AA? No. Can a narcotic addict who is also an addict or also an alcoholic be a member of AA? Yes, as long as he's an alcoholic. Without being an alcoholic, you can't be a member, a practicing member of Alcoholics Anonymous. Not because you're bad or because you're better than us or worse than us. We don't identify with you. That's all. So the whole concept of loosening up and letting non-alcoholics in, some places they do that. Some small towns, I've seen places where they let anybody off the street participate in their participation meetings. Not even just Al-Anons, but passersby. What do you think of that? Huh? It's an amazing thing. So I think what you and I have to do is weather the fear of not being liked tremendously by telling people, if you're not an alcoholic, you cannot participate in our meetings. And if it's a closed meeting, that does not mean closed to the elements. It means closed to non-alcoholics. That's what it means. That has no other meaning. But many people don't understand that. Oh, yeah, we just have a closed meeting, just AA's and Al-Anons and new. You know. No. That's what that is. So I think it's almost safe to say that that period of disunity should be eliminated. We are Alcoholics Anonymous. Let me tell you, I'll tell you in a minute. We'll get back to that. I'm still waiting for 9 things you're going to get back to, Charlie. But, I don't judge. One of the great things these days are more and more people are trying to abolish the Lord's Prayer at the end of meetings. Now, we all said it here. It seems it didn't hurt us any. But in much of the world, whoever started AA in Europe started without the Lord's Prayer. Whoever started AA in Australia started. We have a little missionary in Australia who's got 2 or 3 meetings saying the Lord's Prayer now, but it's surrounded by people who don't. And in the United States, it becomes more and more an effort to defend it. In fact, if you were at the International Convention in San Antonio, you heard the Lord's Prayer once in a four-day period. I spoke at the World Service Office at their big meeting there last summer, and I noticed they closed the meeting with the Lord with the Serenity Prayer. I said, why don't you say the Lord's Prayer? We don't want to offend anyone. We don't want to offend anyone. And what is it offensive in the Lord's Prayer, may I ask? Well, it was said by Jesus. It's a Christian prayer. It isn't a Christian prayer. He was a rabbi when he said it. It's a Jewish prayer. That's why I hate it, you know. But there's nothing that I can think of in the Lord's Prayer that is not said or implied in the 12 steps. It's very clear. Nothing big there. But people, just for something to do. And now they have a new movement in New York, big into getting into, you don't have to believe in any higher power. They have the Atheists Alcoholics Anonymous movement and the Agnostics, up north in Canada. I happen to know from a friend of mine here. They, a year or so ago, they got passed in their territorial legislature a law prohibiting discrimination against people because of their religion or non-religious beliefs. So now they have a group of these Atheistic Alcoholics Anonymous, theoretically, movements, and the central office up there has refused to list them as a meeting. And now they're preparing to sue AA for millions of dollars. Isn't that something? They stop at nothing, these people. I don't know why. What the hell's wrong with them? If they don't like AA, go somewhere. That's where Synanon came from. The guy in Synanon, Chuck, I don't know if you ever heard of Synanon. You ever heard of Synanon? But he was an AA member that I knew. And he started a little tender loving care club out in the beach. And he didn't like the steps. He had all this God crap, he said. So he left the steps, but just took out all references to God. And the AA central office refused to list him. He said, whatever you're doing there, it isn't AA. So he said, well, just screw you then. He threw out all the alcoholics, took in narcotics addicts. I said, what are you doing that? He said, they got no central office. And he started the Synanon, which became a tremendous big organization, and finally got so big and top heavy it toppled in its own corruption. And the last gasp, they went to found Chuck at his daughter's house in Phoenix. He never took a drug in his life. Sitting there with a bottle of whiskey. Sorry. But I don't know why people cannot understand. Alcoholics Anonymous means Alcoholics Anonymous. It does not mean various types of whatever you'd like that for it to be. And the concept, you know, even so when you think about it, at least to me, I don't know what they're worried about anyway. You say, we ask you to believe in a power greater than yourself as you understand him. That could be anything, anybody, anything. My higher power was my sponsor. I couldn't accept God because I got mad at God because when I was in jail one night, he killed my son. And I ended God, you Norwegian Lutheran son of a bitch, you may get me in hell, but you won't get me in Len. And I went to AA off and on for the next years after that. I never stayed sober, but so I stayed in AA until he started talking about God and I get up and leave. I don't want to hear that crap. And my sponsor said to me, we have to start working on the steps. After he had laboriously explained to me why I was an alcoholic, which is I think once you can believe you're an alcoholic, you can do almost anything in AA, but that's the tough one. The first two, three steps have kept more people out of AA, I think, than anything ever happened. But he said, I can't believe in a God. He said, fortunately, you don't have to return to any God. Oh, to a power greater than myself, Bob? Does that fool the others? I know who the hell they're talking about. He says, it doesn't say that. Look at the wall. It says you come to believe in something. We never ask you to go back to any old sick, superstitious belief. We ask you to come to believe in something. And all you have to believe is that there's a power here. Don't even have to know what it is. You give a name for it if you want to. But all these people didn't stay sober just to fool you. there's a power here that they're using. And then he gave me the final killer. He said, to restore you to sanity. And I was sensitive about that because I spent some time in the Texas Insane Asylum. And it was a bum steer. I was in there, not for being mentally ill, but just for being a successful suicide. And what's sanity? I'm an intellectual. I don't want to hear your two-bit reasons in AA. And it turns out you can read 10 textbooks on mental health and get 10 different definitions of sanity. Choose the one you like. However, insanity is relatively easy to define. Isn't that funny? When the human brain is under such intense conflict, it can no longer maintain its neural integrity, it will alter its perception of reality. That is called psychosis, one form of, the most common form of mental illness. And if the whole world changes, they can put you away. But usually it has to be channeled. Mostly it's just something that has to lay rampant in your system, like you read in the paper. I was living next door to this guy for 10 years, a nice guy. Came home one night, took a rifle, killed his kids, killed his wife, killed himself. Why did he do that? Something triggered his psychosis, I guess. But here's an interesting thing. To become an alcoholic, you realize, as we heard so well from my previous speakers, that alcoholism is really consists of having an unnatural reaction to alcohol. And that unnatural reaction to alcohol is that it almost instantly alters my perception of reality. It makes it softer, it makes it more, I fit in, I'm empowered. The thing that makes an alcoholic, I don't think it can be said too often. They say, how many times do you have to be in jail to be an alcoholic? How many times do you have to be in the nut house? How much do you have to lose? Nothing. You have to get an unnatural reaction to alcohol. That's all. That's all that makes an alcoholic. And as a result of that, it will alter your perception of reality when you're sober, until pretty soon alcohol becomes a problem and sobriety is a bigger problem. And that phenomenon is called alcoholism. And that's why most people who have it die from it and disbelieving they have it. If my problem were alcohol, why do I feel so bad sober? Common cry of every alcoholic, you know. But it's the interesting thing. Alcoholics almost never become psychotic. Isn't that amazing? You'd think we'd be the number one candidates. They treat me bad and they look to be funny. Why don't alcoholics become psychotic? And the guy explained that to me funny one day in Washington. And I thought, of course. Oh yeah, I said. He said, when alcoholics feel bad enough, long enough, they will drink alcohol, whoever they are, which will alter their perception of reality. So it turns out you and I have the power, although we don't know it, to induce temporary psychosis. Happy days. And tomorrow you'll be back to reality, perhaps. But so I guess what Alcoholics Anonymous means by the second step is this had to be pointed out to me. I have to come to believe in a power greater than myself, which I chose. I said to my sponsor said to me, can't you believe in a loving God? And I said, no, now or never. He said, can't you believe in AA? I said, I like it better than I used to, but not much. He says, you think I'm doing better than you are? Of course you are. He said, congratulations. I'm your new higher power. And I could accept that because I knew he was trying to help me. But the purpose of that step is to come to believe that there's some power here that will make it unnecessary for me to drink alcohol. Boom. It's a hard thing to realize, but that's the way it goes. And it's so important. You know, I want to go backtrack just a little bit to the Lord's Prayer. People say, why do we say the Lord's Prayer? You are about to find out. My name is Charlie, and I'm an alcoholic. No, that's not it. It's a letter from Bill Wilson, dated April 14, 1959. How about this business of adding the Lord's Prayer to each AA meeting? This practice properly came from the Oxford groups who were influential in the early days of AA. You have probably noted in AA Comes of Age what the connection of these people with AA really was. I think saying the Lord's Prayer was a custom of theirs following the close of each meeting. Therefore, it quite generally got into a usage amongst us. Of course, there are always those who seem to be offended by the introduction of any prayer into an ordinary AA gathering. Also, it is sometimes complained that the Lord's Prayer is a Christian document. Nevertheless, this prayer is of such widespread use and recognition that the argument of its Christian origin seemed to be a little far-fetched. It is also true that AAs believe in some kind of God, and that communication and strength is obtainable through His grace. Since this is the general consensus, it seems only right that at least the Serenity Prayer and the Lord's Prayer be used in connection with our meetings. It does not seem necessary to defer to the feelings of our agnostic and atheistic newcomers to the extent of completely hiding our light under their bushel. However, around here, the leader in the meeting usually asks those to join him in the Lord's Prayer who feel they would care to do so. The worst that happens to the objectors is that they have to listen to it. This is doubtless a salutary exercise in tolerance at their stage of development. So that's the use of some of the Lord's Prayers as I recall it. Just interesting. And you want to hear a religious prayer? God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as the pathway to peace. Taking as Jesus did this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it. Trusting that He will make all things right is surrender to His will. That I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with Jesus forever in the next. Amen. That's the Serenity Prayer as it was written. We snatched part of it, but it's a little more religious than the Lord's Prayer. But to objectors, it doesn't seem to make much difference. The idea that we have to have a power here that we can believe in has kept generations of alcoholics of our type. It's flabbergasting when you stop and think there are 4,000 years of written history of ineffectual treatment on people like us. And so what, 76, 77 years of effective treatment. And the people want to change the 77 years to something, go back to the 4,000 years of ineffectual treatment. It's ridiculous. But anyway, the last thing I want to talk about quickly is the idea of anonymity. You know, as I told you, in the New York Times recently, there's been a couple long letters preaching why to get rid of anonymity. Why do we have anonymity? We don't need it anymore. Maybe once upon a time when you come out of a meeting in 1938 or something, but not now. It's kind of a mark of distinction to be a successful AA member. Every movie star that gets a traffic ticket goes into recovery. It's a tough thing. And they stay in recovery until they get out. But what's the purpose of anonymity? I know when I really learned it strongly when I was new. They told me about anonymity, But when I was new, there was a woman named Lillian Roth, famous singer of that time. And she wrote a book called I'll Cry Tomorrow, later made into a movie with Susan Hayward. And she talked about how her life had been changed by Alcoholics Anonymous. And her sponsor said, Lillian, I don't think you ought to do that. In fact, I heard her talk about it one time. Don't think you ought to do that. That's kind of violates our traditions. She said, when people discover that Lillian Roth are in AA, they'll want to come. And a couple years later, when she laid face down drunk in her own vomit in Palm Springs, I don't know how much of a drawing card she was for AA then, I don't think anybody paid much attention to it. The next year, John Barrymore's daughter, Diana Barrymore, wrote a book called Too Much Too Soon. And she commended Alcoholics Anonymous for the wonderful help it had given her She had now been able, she's come to learn to drink socially through AA. And the next year when she died in the drunk tank in Malibu, I guess her exercise didn't get very far. But I watched people year after year break their anonymity, and I've never seen anybody profit from it. Now, I don't really believe that God in heaven saying, that person broke their anonymity, I'm going to get them. Why would they have bad luck? I would think it boils down to, it's almost as though we have a tent. Like this particular weekend, we have a tent where people are talking about the 12 steps underneath that tent, and we come and listen to them. When people violate the tenets of AA, they put themselves above the tent, say, I'm going to help AA now. I don't need help from them. Don't help them anymore. I'm going to let them know, as a number of people have done over the years. And they do fine until the cold wind blows. There's no place for them to go. And anonymity seems to be a destructive force. But probably the people who most complain about anonymity never seem to understand it is not for protection anyway, not for a long time. It is an exercise in intellectual subordination of your ego, putting a cap on your ego. And some of you may not know what anonymity consists of. I, because of the nature of my work in Los Angeles, I get, I used to get more, but I get a lot of ink and get interviewed on television, and I get stories written about me in the paper and all sorts of things. And they always identify me as a recovering alcoholic. And people write me letters, you've broken your anonymity. No, I haven't. I am a recovering alcoholic. What I cannot do is say I'm an AA member or ever mention AA. Once I mention AA, the last name is gone, the face is gone, nothing's right. You know, just, it is absolutely, and what, that's not to protect AA, that is, so I do not get carried away with my own BS. That's the number one reason, it's to protect me against me, because self-obsessed people don't know where to stop. And that's a good place to stop. And that's what anonymity is. And that's why we have to continue it. And the guy that writes the letter to the paper puts his full name in and address as if to show, look, I'm breaking my anonymity. And all, most of you think, screw you, you know, that's all. Who cares? If everybody in AA breaks their anonymity except me, I'm not going to break mine. Not except wonderful, but because I know where it goes when I start taking self-aggrandizement as a big thing with me. And you know, we think about, I was thinking today, Bill Wilson, he's practically sanctified now. You know, you new people, all these pictures back here, Bill Wilson. I just the other night at last week at that convention in Atlanta, I saw When Love Is Not Enough, that great story about the early days of AA and founding Bill Wilson. And he's almost like a saint. And it's hard to remember, when he was alive, he was under a great deal of attack by members of AA. Many members of AA hated Bill Wilson, shook their fists against him. In 1960, a group of people in Chicago wrote him a letter saying they were terribly disillusioned by him because he wasn't the type of leader we should have. And his answer was, and he whips out another sheet of paper, that you seem disillusioned with me personally may be a new and painful experience for you, but many members have had that experience with me. Most of their pain has been caused not only by my several shortcomings, but by their own insistence on placing me, a drunk trying to get along with the other drunks, upon a completely illusory pedestal, a station which no fallible person could possibly occupy. I'm sure you will understand that I've never held myself out to anybody as either a saint or a Superman. I've repeatedly and truthfully said that AA is full of people who have made more spiritual progress than I have or can. That in some areas of living I've made some decided gains. That in others I seem to have stood still, and in other ways I may have even gone backward. I am sorry you are disillusioned, but I'm happy that even I have found a life here. Isn't that a touching little letter from Bill Wilson? Great, listen. And I've told you just about everything I know now, but I'm going to read one more thing. My pockets are just full of information. This was written written by a guy in Australia, an AA that I know in Australia. And it's the most touching thing. And it really is a good thing to end the night on, I think. It's just called Drunks. Listen to this. We died of pneumonia in furnished rooms where they found us 3 days later when somebody complained about the smell. We died against bridge abutments and nobody knew if it was suicide, and we probably didn't know either, except in the sense it was always suicide. We died in hospitals, our stomachs huge, distended, there was nothing they could do. We died in cells, never knowing whether we were guilty or not. We went to priests, they gave us pledges, they told us to pray, they told us to go and sin no more, but go! We tried and we died. We died of overdoses, we died in bed, we died in straitjackets, in the DT, seeing God knows what creeping, stittering, slithering, shuffling thing is crawling on us. And you know what the worst thing was? The worst thing was that nobody ever believed how hard we tried. We went to doctors and they gave us stuff to take that would make us sick when we drank on the principle, well, it's so crazy, it just might work, I guess. Or maybe they just shook their heads and sent us to places like Kelly's drying out's place. And we tried. Humph. And when we got out, we were so hooked on pills, or maybe we lied to the doctors and they told us not to drink so much, just drink like me. So we tried and we died. We drowned in our own vomit or choked on it, our broken jaws wired shut. We died playing Russian roulette and people thought we'd lost, but we knew better. We died under the hoofs of horses, under the wheels of vehicles, under the knives and boot heels of our brother drunks. We died in shame. And you know what was even worse? We couldn't even believe it ourselves that we had tried. We figured we were just thought we tried and we died believing we hadn't tried, believing we didn't know what it meant to try. When we were desperate enough or hopeful enough or deluded or embattled enough to go for help, we went to people with letters after their names and prayed that they might have read the right books that had the right words in them, never suspecting the terrifying truth that the right words, as simple as they were, had not been written yet. We died with a shotgun in our mouth or jumping off a bridge, and everybody knew it was suicide. We died under the Harbor Expressway with our hands tied behind us and a bullet in the back of our head, because this time the people that we disappointed were the wrong people. We died in convulsions or of insult to the brain, as we called it. We died incontinent and in disgrace, abandoned. If we were women, we died degraded, because women have so much more to live up to. We tried and we died, and nobody cried. And the very worst thing was that for every one of us that died, there were another 100 of us or another 1,000 who wished that we could die, who went to sleep praying we would not have to wake up because what we were enduring was intolerable and we knew in our hearts it wasn't ever going to change. One day in a hospital room in New York City, one of us had what the books called a transforming spiritual experience. And he said to himself, I've got it. No, he didn't. He only got part of it. And I have to share it, he said. And then he almost got it. We tried and we died. One last cigarette, the comfort of glowing in the dark. We passed out and the bed caught fire. They said we suffocated before our body burned. They said we never felt a thing, that this was the best way maybe we died, except sometimes we took our family with us. And the man in New York was so sure he had it, he tried to pray us into sobriety, but that didn't work either. Prayer confuses drunks, and he tried, and we still died. One after another, we got his hopes up, and we broke his heart, because that's what we do. And the worst thing was that every time we thought we knew what the worst thing was, something happened that was worse. Until a day came in a hotel lobby, and it wasn't in Rome or Jerusalem or Mecca or Dublin or even South Boston. It was in Akron, for Christ's sake. A man came when the man said, I have to find a drunk because I need him as much as he needs me. Now we had it. And the transmission line after all those years was open. The transmission line was open. And now we don't go to priests, and we don't go to doctors and people with letters after their names. We come to people who have been there, and we come to each other, and we try, and we don't have to die. And we don't have to die. Thank you.